welcome everyone to the October 2017 edition of Hedge Funds Nuts and Bolts. We're going to be talking today about direct lending fund structures. Presenting with me today are Richard Horowitz, a partner of mine here in New York, who is in our financial services group, and Adrian Baker in our Boston office, who is in our tax group. With that, Richard, if you're ready to kick us off.
Thank you, Russell. I would make a couple of starting points at a high level, right? Demand and supply forces continue to be very favorable for private credit and private credit funds. On the supply side, as we all know, since the financial crisis, big banks are not lending to small and middle market companies. Regional banks, which had been lending to those companies, have been acquired or are also looking to lend to larger companies. As a result, private credit funds have been established since the financial crisis in large numbers, have entered this vacuum, and there continues to be a lot of interest in these funds. On the demand side, companies, I think small and middle market companies, are finding it very attractive to establish relationships with some of the large credit managers. On the investor side, investors continue to look for income. Interest rates remain at zero in the U.S. and around the world. Investors want exposure to a U.S. direct lending strategy that's both U.S. investors and non-U.S. investors. Again, that includes U.S. tax-exempt investors. We'll talk more about those two classes, tax-exempts and non-U.S. investors, when we talk a little bit about BDCs and closed-end funds and the advantages of those fund structures. Last week, we co-published a very interesting white paper with the Alternative Credit Council of AIMA, the Alternative Investment Managers Association. The paper is called Financing the Economy 2017, The Role of Private Credit Managers in Supporting Economic Growth. The paper was produced based on a survey of a number of private credit managers. Interviews were done with several of these managers. These are both U.S. and non-U.S. managers. And they presented a number of case studies in terms of the types of loans they were making to small and middle market companies. We've attached the paper to this webinar. It's a very interesting read. I would briefly summarize some of the key takeaways from the survey. Estimates are that private credit should exceed $1 trillion by 2020. It was $600 billion at the end of 2016. Since 2000, private credit investments have grown by 14 times. That translates to an annual growth rate of about 20% a year. Again, very strong. The biggest lending opportunities are in the U.S., the U.K., Germany, France, and Canada. I think those countries make a lot of sense in terms of lending opportunities given their sophisticated regulatory and legal infrastructures. One of the interesting takeaways I thought was the three key attractions for borrowers. One, the flexibility of terms that private credit managers can provide. Two, speed of their decision making, and three, the ability to finance complex deals. What I found really interesting about these three key attractions was they are non-financial factors largely. And again, going to the point that borrowers are looking to establish long-term relationships with these credit managers. Another takeaway, managers are diversifying the ways they source deals. They obviously continue to work with their private equity networks. They are teaming up with banks. And so, again, large banks where there is an opportunity for a large syndicated loan to one of these companies, private credit managers may come in and participate in a junior piece in the capital structure, but that they are building relationships with some of the banks. And last takeaway, 44% of managers use no leverage at all. I think that's really interesting. A larger percentage use some leverage, but not a lot of leverage. And again, I'd like to come back to that point later when we talk about BDCs and closed-end funds, which are interesting fund structures that you should, I think about in your menu of fund options, especially where the strategy does not involve a lot of leverage. Turn it back to Russell to talk about private fund structures.
Okay. Some of the items that Richard touched on, in terms of these, the concerns that arise from these direct lending funds, one that we'll touch on repeatedly is the potential mismatch between the duration and maturity of these loans and the liquidity that fund sponsors are often looking to provide to their investors. This also is something that greatly concerns the regulators when they look at the space and are wondering about the ability of funds to provide liquidity should there ever be another 2008. Along those lines, we are in a crisis situation and we see a real degradation in terms of the amount of equity cushion that we have with respect to these loans, then that raises a lot of concerns as well. And then finally, just the overall level of leverage in the system is of a great concern to regulators as they try to figure out what kind of threat this direct lending space presents. Shadow banking is their preferred term rather than direct lending, but either way, whether you use the more sinister or less sinister, that's the underlying concern there. Turning then to some direct lending fund structure issues, we're going to start with what in some ways is the simplest approach to setting up vehicles for direct lending strategies, which are private funds. In terms of what's most common in the market, it's a private equity style model, meaning a closed-end fund with a certain life term, lifespan that is not registered and is only available via private placement. The reason that we're seeing sponsors, including those that traditionally have been in the hedge fund space, use a private equity model are ones that we'll go into some more detail. In particular, before taking a quick look at some of the basic terms of these funds, I wanted to mention a bit about the fund structures. For tax reasons that Richard alluded to and Adrian's going to describe further, we're usually looking at both an onshore, i.e. Delaware, fund that is a limited partnership, and an offshore, often Cayman fund. The exact structure that's used and which fund certain investors will want to be in will depend on whether there's significant non-U.S. investment expected and on whether the funds will themselves be borrowing, and the resulting ECI issues for non-U.S. investors and UBTI issues for U.S. tax-exempt investors that would arise in those circumstances. The structure, what are some of the distinguishing features that we see in a private equity structure for direct lending? The first is that while investors typically have no ability to redeem or withdraw from the fund, the funds do have a finite life. Many of these funds expect to provide regular distributions, but in any event, they hope to return all the capital contributions and a significant profit to the investors by the end of the life of the fund. In other private equity style spaces, we see a term more like 10 years, but it's usually significantly shorter in the direct lending space, typically in the 6-year range. The second feature is we have a multi-year investment period, which is time period during which the manager makes or acquires the loans, which is usually 2 to 3 years in the direct lending space. Because the loans are accumulated over an extended period, the manager typically does not require or permit investors to fund everything on day one. Instead, capital is called down as needed during or even after the investment period. And because the investors are participating pro rata in the same pool of loans, the manager typically holds more than one closing to admit investors over a period of months, with latecomers paying their pro rata share of what they would have paid if they'd been in from day one, together with an adjustment factor. What are some of the issues that arise on terms in these private equity-style direct lending funds, some of which are common to other private equity-style funds? First, as mentioned, when someone comes in a later closing, we need to adjust how much they pay. In an equity fund, it's usually just a straight 8% or so per annum additional amount, or whatever the preferred return is in that fund. As first closers typically haven't received any return on their investment, and valuations, importantly, don't shift very quickly in most of these funds. That model may not work as well when first closers have been receiving distributions that represent interest and possibly principal in the interim, and where the valuations can change much more rapidly. So we have to work with managers to determine how subsequent closings should operate and what that adjustment factor should be. Similarly, managers have to agree with investors on the circumstances in which the manager can recycle amounts that otherwise would be distributable to LPs and new investments, and where they can call capital after the investment period or can extend the investment period if capital hasn't been fully deployed. Investors less familiar with PE funds should also understand that if they come into a subsequent closing, that they'll be responsible for their share of previously incurred expenses. Management fees, always an important topic to fund sponsors. The traditional management fee structure in private equity style funds is to take 2%, or these days perhaps some lesser percent, per annum of the capital commitments during the investment period, and then a similar percentage of the net invested capital thereafter, with net invested capital typically reduced by any investments that are written off or in some cases that are written down. One variation of that that we've seen with some frequency in the direct lending space is to base it on net invested capital both in the investment period and thereafter. And another common structure in this space is to look not to capital commitments or net invested capital at all, but rather to base the fee on a percentage of NAV, which is, of course, more familiar to hedge fund investors and sponsors. The issue that can arise here is that, unlike in the typical hedge fund space, many of these private loans are difficult to value and don't have any marks out there in the market that can be used easily. So basing the management fee on NAV puts additional pressure on the manager's valuation policy and procedures. In most of these structures today, including in the direct lending space, the manager and its affiliate shares in the profits not by getting an annual performance fee or by getting a portion of the profits on each deal, but rather the investors get a return of their capital, then a compounded preferred return, typically in the 6 to 8% range, and then the sponsor catches up on profits until it's gotten typically 20% of them, with the investors and sponsor sharing 80-20 on all remaining amounts. That's the most vanilla example. There are a lot of wrinkles that we see, but there are usually variations on this theme. Next slide. This shows that in visual form, where everything up to the 7% threshold is going to the investors, then you have some degree of catch-up followed by a preferred return, followed by the 80-20 split thereafter. The other structure that we do see in the direct lending space, although much less often, is a more typical hedge fund structure. If for one reason or another someone wants to go this way, the two primary concerns are liquidity and tax issues. On the first, the manager needs to find a way to ensure that money won't try to leave more quickly than the liquidity of the portfolio allows. There are a few ways that managers can look to address this. The first is simply to lock it up. That works great for the lockup period, but first of all, you have to be able to sell that to investors, which can require fee breaks, among other things. And second of all, will that give you enough time to realize your return on the loans and generate enough liquidity in the portfolio? A second option is to be able to pull down a gate, which works reasonably well in most cases, but investors don't love signing up for these either. Next, we can have the ability to side pocket loans, but investors will typically seek to limit this to a certain percentage of the assets or to certain types of investments, which may not be sufficient for the particular strategy. And then finally, there are slow pay mechanics pursuant to which investors are only entitled to receive a return as loans pay off, which is similar to side pocketing. So having highlighted some of the issues that arise using both private equity and hedge fund structures, Richard, what's another path that we can go down here?
Sure, Russell. The tax-driven nature of originating loans in the U.S., giving rise to ECI or UBTI, has led many managers to look at business development companies and closed-end funds. The Investment Company Act talks about three different types of funds: an open-end fund, otherwise known as a mutual fund, a closed-end fund, and a business development company. A BDC is a type of closed-end fund. It can be publicly offered or privately placed. In the last several years, we've seen many privately placed BDCs. More on that shortly. The BDC's focus is on making equity or fixed income investments in small and middle market companies, private U.S. companies. Again, more on that in a second. The BDC provisions of the 40 Act were put in place in 1980 following the really bad stock market of the 1970s and the really difficult capital formation environment of the 1970s. And the BDC provisions were originally put in place to provide for venture capital type investments in small companies that would ultimately look to list. And the thought was to help grow small companies. BDCs would provide venture capital type financing. That has morphed, I would say, in the last 10 to 15 years, where most BDCs have a fixed income strategy, not an equity strategy. Again, most BDCs today are externally managed by the investment advisor. And here's really the key aspect of a BDC from the standpoint of appealing to tax-exempt and non-U.S. investors. A BDC complies with what's called the RIC rule, subchapter M of the Internal Revenue Code. We're going to ask Adrian to speak about that in a second. Complying with the RIC rules allows a BDC to be treated as a corporation for U.S. tax purposes, and there's no entity-level tax. Very powerful in that the BDC itself becomes the blocker, becomes the ECI and UBTI blocker. And again, we're going to talk more about that. There are many BDCs that are listed on the New York Stock Exchange. You can, but you don't need to list on a stock exchange. BDC is interesting from the standpoint of the advisor in that a BDC can be charged both management fees and full-blown performance fees under the Investment Company Act and under the Advisors Act. The performance fee is typically bifurcated into two pieces, performance fee on income, which is taken quarterly, and a performance fee on capital gains, which is taken annually. A BDC has more ability to use leverage. We say 50% of total assets versus 33 and a third. Another way of saying that is a BDC with $100 of assets can borrow up to $100. At that point, the BDC has $200 of total assets, $100 of borrowings. That's also referred to as the 200% asset coverage ratio, whereas a closed-end fund that has $100 can borrow up to $50. At that point, it has $150 of total assets, $50 of borrowings. That's referred to as the 300% asset coverage ratio. So BDC can use more leverage. Many managers have opted for BDC for that reason, to be able to not go up to the highest level of leverage, but to use more leverage than they could in a closed-end fund. BDC has an ability to issue shares for less than its net asset value. You do need to get prior shareholder approval to do that. We'll talk a little bit more about that. And there's some flexibility to engage in affiliated transactions that a BDC has, which a closed-end fund does not. Potential investment focus of BDCs, again, in the last 10, 15 years, almost all BDCs have been fixed income focused. They've been making senior loans, senior secured loans, mezzanine loans, perhaps receiving an equity kicker, receiving warrants. Again, the key is to comply with the RIC rules and the income distribution requirements of the RIC rules tend to favor investments with current cash payments such as mezzanine and senior debt. Potential benefits of a BDC structure versus a private fund structure. The BDC is not a bank. It is not subject to the restrictions of being a bank. BDCs are subject to many of the provisions of the Investment Company Act, and so you do need to navigate through the corporate governance provisions of the 40 Act. You need to have an independent board of directors and so on, and then most of the anti-affiliation provisions of the 40 Act do apply to BDCs. A BDC can do a public offering, right, can do an IPO and listing. And that was the case, I would say, up until the early 2000s. Most BDCs did an IPO with an underwriting syndicate, just like a listed closed-end fund. They would raise $500 million, whatever the amount is, and they would list on the stock exchange, and their shares would trade above or below the net asset value. It is a permanent capital vehicle at that point, which is attractive, of course, to many managers. The last bullet on the page, alternative approach of an unlisted continuously offered BDC has emerged recently. And really, when we turn to the next slide, private BDCs are becoming extremely popular, right? A private BDC really is a private, can be operated as a private fund with a BDC wrapper for tax treatment. A private BDC can have a finite term, just like the finite term that Russell described for his private fund. You can have a private BDC that seeks to do an IPO and listing after a certain period of time. Many of the private BDCs we've set up recently have lower management fees and performance fees in the private stage, which automatically kick into higher management fees and performance fees in the public stage. As a result, the fees can be somewhat customized for large institutional clients, which is interesting. And so if you have five or six seed investors who are willing to give you $400, $500 million, you can charge them a lower management fee and performance fee in the private stage. Perhaps you can give them a piece of the advisor to the BDC. That's complicated and is probably the subject for its own webinar. But then those fees can increase automatically in the public stage, at which point some of those seed investors can begin perhaps to sell their shares in the public market. And the last bullet really, again, is the key bullet. A BDC is appealing for U.S. tax-exempt investors and non-U.S. investors because it itself serves as the UBTI and ECI blocker. And maybe at this point, I ask Adrian to talk a little bit about the requirements of Subchapter M and what a BDC needs to do to comply with Subchapter M to get this blocking treatment.
So I should point out that the explosion of interest in BDCs as direct lending fund vehicles really has come about because of a change in the Internal Revenue Code that allows the character of U.S. source interest as well as short-term capital gains to flow through the fund to its shareholders. Without that, a non-U.S. investor in one of these funds would receive those earnings in the form of an ordinary dividend, which is subject to a 30% withholding tax, would be considered a U.S. source dividend. It could be somewhat reduced by treaty for an eligible shareholder, although most U.S. treaties generally would not reduce that rate to anything below 15%. So what the change in law does is makes permanent a provision that had been a patch that had to continually be extended by Congress year after year, that allows the nature of portfolio interest, which is U.S. source interest income received by the fund, flow through to its shareholders and therefore generally escape withholding tax. Similarly, short-term gains are not subject to withholding tax. You still get the ECI blocking nature because of the fact that this is a corporate fund vehicle. Long-term gains always had the potential to flow through one of these vehicles, but of course, this type of a vehicle is not really expected to generate much in the way of long-term gains. It's really the ability of the interest to flow through that's key here. In order to qualify for this special tax treatment, the BDC or private closed-end fund version of BDC needs to satisfy the same rules that apply under the tax code to U.S. mutual funds. It's not as though they are completely exempt from the payment of U.S. tax. It's that they get a dividends paid deduction for earnings that are paid out to their shareholders. So to the extent that earnings are distributed on a current basis to shareholders, the fund gets a deduction and therefore can zero out its tax liability. To qualify for this special treatment, fund would have to distribute at least 90% of its annual gross income. Of course, it would want to do more than that because any undistributed earnings would be subject to entity level tax. It also must satisfy an asset diversification test. And the reason for this really precedes any notion of these rules applying to BDCs. It's because mutual funds were viewed as retail structures, and the asset diversification requirement was meant to reduce risk and therefore spare the small retail investor from potential risk associated with lack of asset diversification. Also, there are certain qualifying income tests, which really has a similar basis. At least 90% of the annual gross income of the RIC must come from certain qualifying sources of income, such as interest, dividends, capital gains from the distribution of interest and dividends, foreign currencies, derivative positions on securities, other income connected with the business of trading in securities. Notably, there's been areas of interest to expand into, say, physical commodities that have come close to passing through Congress but been shot down for various reasons. Of course, that's really not of import in this context, but it just gives you a general flavor of how these funds operate. So it's fair to say there is a fair amount of compliance that you must be aware of. It would be similar as though you were operating a retail mutual fund from a tax perspective. Richard?
That's great, Adrian. Thank you. An interesting question from one of our attendees on this webinar. Can a private fund convert to a BDC? And the answer is yes, right? And we have set up private funds which have the optionality to convert to a BDC. We've set up Delaware Limited Partnerships or Delaware LLC, private fund offered to U.S. taxable investors with the option, if they have a non-U.S. distribution strategy or a U.S. tax-exempt strategy, in terms of bringing those investors into the fund to convert to a BDC down the road. It's complicated, but the documents can be set up in a way where that conversion would not require limited partner approval. It's preset in the documents. The general partner could make that election, at which point the Delaware LLC or LP presumably would convert by operation of law to our vehicle of choice, which would be a Delaware statutory trust. And at that point, a board of directors would be put in place that would comply with the 40 Act requirements to have a majority of the directors be independent of the advisor, and all of the BDC policies and procedures would need to be put in place at that time. So an interesting optionality strategy, which some of our clients have been using in the last couple of years. Just to hit on some of the key aspect of what the BDC needs to focus on, at least 70% of a BDC's portfolio must be invested in what are called eligible portfolio companies, EPCs for short. An eligible portfolio company has three prongs to it. It must be a U.S. company, it must be a private company, and it must be an operating company. Certain companies like certain funds, a private fund that relies on 3C1 or 3C7 for its 40 Act exemption is not an eligible portfolio company. A bank or an insurance company or a broker-dealer is not an eligible portfolio company. A couple of years ago, the SEC revised the definition so that it does include very small U.S. public companies, a company with a market capitalization of less than $250 million. The 70% test is an incurrence test, which means that an increase in the value of a non-EPC investment, a non-EPC investment would be a loan to a non-U.S. company, right? I said an EPC needs to be a U.S. private operating company. If the value of the loan to a non-U.S. company increases, at which point the non-EPC basket is in at 32% and the EPC basket is in at 68%. That is not a violation of the 40 Act. At that point, the BDC would need to make another EPC investment and would need to get back over the 70% threshold to be in compliance with the 40 Act provisions. So it is an incurrence test, which is helpful to managing the portfolio. One of the interesting prongs of the 40 Act, a BDC must offer to provide significant managerial assistance, which is a defined term, to each eligible portfolio company. This is a bit of a vestige provision when Congress in 1980 thought that BDCs would actually provide management advice to these small growing U.S. companies, especially if they were investing in the equity of the company. Today, a fixed income focused BDC sends a letter technically to the eligible portfolio company saying, we are a BDC, we are offering to provide significant managerial assistance to you, and that offer typically is not taken up by the portfolio company. The sending of that managerial assistance letter satisfies the requirement of the 40 Act. BDCs can be compared to closed-end funds, and I think a registered closed-end fund should also be something that you should think about in your menu of fund options. A closed-end fund in many ways is similar to a BDC. Most unlisted, continuously offered closed-end funds do provide some liquidity to investors. There are two abilities to provide liquidity. One is under the interval fund rule, and one is under the tender offer fund rule. You don't have to provide liquidity to investors. As Russell said, if you want to have a closed-end fund which has a six-year term and will liquidate at the end of 6 years, subject to board of directors delaying that liquidation for another year or two, if they think it's in the best interest of the fund, you can set up the fund with no redemption, no repurchase option for shareholders. They're totally locked up. And we have set up closed-end funds like that. If you do want to provide some liquidity, you can do quarterly repurchases either under the interval fund rule or the tender offer rule. An interesting aspect of closed-end funds is that you can obtain SEC exemptive relief to offer multiple classes of shares. And here in mutual fund land, most mutual funds have many different share classes, right? And those share classes are based on the different distribution strategies that the mutual fund is employing. And so you can have a broker-dealer share class, which has an upfront sales load that goes to the brokers. You can have a registered investment advisor class, which has no upfront sales load. And you can have everything in between, right? A smaller upfront sales load, an annual distribution fee, an annual shareholder servicing fee, and so on. There are many unlisted, continuously offered closed-end funds that have obtained SEC exemptive relief to offer multiple classes of shares. And this is an interesting strategy in that you can employ multiple distribution efforts, and you can build that distribution strategy over time. As you take in money on a monthly basis, let's say, for the closed-end fund. So again, that's something to keep in mind, which to me makes a closed-end fund quite interesting. The chart on the next page has a lot of good information in it. It is comparing and contrasting, right, a closed-end fund to a BDC. There's a lot here. We're happy to answer any questions that you may have. I'm not going to go through this chart. I'm going to hit on some of the what I think are the key points to this chart. Both a closed-end fund and a BDC can do a public offering or a private placement. Both are treated as a corporation for tax purposes. As Adrian described, the subchapter M requirements, if a closed-end fund or a BDC is a corporation and complies with subchapter M, it itself is blocking the effectively connected income or the UBTI and is really a very clean tax structure for non-U.S. as well as U.S. tax-exempt investors. On the leverage front, again, as I discussed, a closed-end fund can use less leverage than a BDC. Again, depending on who your investors are, what their appetite is for the use of leverage, might push you towards a BDC if you do need to use more leverage. And on the reporting front, very big difference here. A closed-end fund is subject to the 40X reporting requirements. A closed-end fund files an annual and semi-annual report. Very, very easy, straightforward reporting from a 40X standpoint. A BDC is a 34-Act reporting company. It is treated as an operating company for reporting purposes and as a result needs to file 8Ks, 10Qs, and a 10K. Much more complicated from a reporting perspective. It takes a lot more time and effort for the management team to produce those reports for BDC. More complicated, again, from a legal review, auditor review, and so on. Again, just the difference in reporting between the two, something that you should be aware of. And again, from a corporate governance standpoint, the two are similar. Both need to have a board of directors, a majority of whom are independent, need to be independent of the advisor. Again, we're happy to sort of get into more detail with you, if you'd like, about the differences and similarities between the two. But I do think that these two vehicles should be considered in the menu of options that you have available in coming up with a direct lending strategy, especially as we've seen a large number of privately offered closed-end funds and BDCs in the last couple of years.
And Adrian, you could talk to us about some tax considerations.
Sure. So whenever we're putting together fund structures, we're always looking to minimize tax leakage, both at the fund level and at the investor level. For the private fund set up, typically that's done by having the private fund be a tax transparent vehicle or perhaps be a corporate vehicle that's organized in a low tax jurisdiction. For non-U.S. investors, with a private lending vehicle, there are some complications with that because most private fund vehicles are efficient for non-U.S. investors because they operate within a statutory trading safe harbor, which allows them to trade in securities, certain commodities, and related derivatives for their own account without being deemed to be engaged in a U.S. trade or business. And as a result, income and gains from that activity are not subject to net income taxation when they're derived by a non-U.S. person, whether it's a non-U.S. investor investing through a tax transparent fund or it's a non-U.S. corporate fund itself. The problem we face with direct lending is that lending activity does not fall within the trading safe harbor. Acquiring debt obligations in the secondary market, so trading in debt obligations for your own account, is within the safe harbor. But originating loans, engaging in a financing business, not within the safe harbor. So we spend a lot of time coming up with how to deal with this problem when we're looking to attract non-U.S. investors. Among the options, there can be corporate blocker structures that are interposed between a non-U.S. investor and the loan portfolio. Mind you, it's the fact that there are either managers located in the United States or there is sufficient activity in the United States because of U.S. borrowers that's creating the U.S. trader business activity. The corporate blocker can act as a shield. However, unless you're able to satisfy the rules that we discussed earlier to qualify for the special RIC or mutual fund tax status, the corporate blocker generally will itself be required to file U.S. returns and pay entity-level taxes. Now, the mutual fund structure, that tax regime applicable to a BDC or a 40 Act registered closed-end fund, if you can fit within the regulatory confines, it is an extremely elegant solution because it allows you to have a corporate blocker that escapes entity-level tax and can commingle the assets of non-U.S. investors, U.S. investors, and U.S. tax-exempt investors in one vehicle. So in essence, it's really the tax lawyer's dream solution when it works. Now, I should point out that this solution, which has the pass-through of portfolio interest, which is how it becomes tax efficient for non-U.S. investors, applies only to U.S. source income. So if you had a fund that were engaging in lending activity with borrowers outside the United States, giving rise to non-U.S. source interest income, you don't have quite the same elegant solution because non-U.S. source interest would flow through the fund vehicle and come out to investors in the form of taxable ordinary income dividends subject to withholding tax. So not quite as efficient a solution. You'd still avoid entity-level tax, but there would be withholding when earnings are paid out in the form of dividends. Moving to the next page, what is another solution that we see in the private fund space? I would say there's more of an appetite for this than the taxable blocker, because the taxable blocker, even if you've tried to finance the blocker in part with debt to try and provide for an interest deduction and therefore some reduction in entity-level tax at the corporate blocker level, this is where we have a taxable blocker that's not trying to satisfy the mutual fund rules, there's still a fair amount of tax leakage. And investors these days seem to be savvy to the fact that there are solutions that can be put in place that don't have that same level of tax leakage. One such solution is the season and sell structure. What this structure is designed to do is create a separate offshore fund vehicle for non-U.S. investors that satisfies certain debt acquisition guidelines that basically create a break between the party that's originating the debt in the United States and the offshore vehicle that's acquiring those debt obligations. There are guidelines that are designed to have that acquisition of debt from U.S. loan originators look to be a secondary market debt transaction so that it falls within the trading safe harbor for funds or non-U.S. persons who are not originating debt but simply acquiring debt obligations in the secondary market. This can be challenging because, of course, there can't be any contemplation up front that the loans being originated will end up in the offshore fund. Otherwise, the activities of the U.S. loan originator get attributed to the offshore fund. There have been a few IRS utterances that address that fact pattern and tag the offshore fund with tax liability. So it does require a source of capital in the U.S. to fund the origination and closing of the loans with the ability to hold on to those loans should the offshore fund opt not to acquire a loan. And part of the season and sell tax guidelines usually requires that there be some independent third party acting on behalf of the offshore fund that can look at any particular issuance and say yes or no to the acquisition of those obligations for the offshore fund. So you can see it's not quite as elegant a solution. It does require separate fund structures, and by design, they will have differing portfolios, and there will be limitations on what the offshore fund can do and when it can do it. For the sake of completeness, I will mention also that there are certain treaty structures that are sometimes used. These, I would say, are available in much more limited circumstances than a season and sell structure. They really require one of two things, either that you have the ability to set up a fund that itself can claim treaty relief, or that you are setting up a fund that is fiscally transparent from the perspective of the investor's jurisdiction, and the investor itself must be eligible to claim treaty relief under a treaty between the United States and its jurisdiction of residence. Mind you that the U.S. treaties have very stringent anti-treaty shopping provisions that can make this difficult, and also business profits that are attributable to a permanent establishment in the United States are fully taxable and not protected by the treaty unless a U.S.-based loan originator has many clients so that it can rightfully say that it is both economically and legally independent of the offshore vehicle acquiring loans. It's possible that the U.S. manager itself could be viewed to create a permanent establishment, again, which would make a treaty position untenable. The last point on treaty structures is that when they work at a federal level, but states are not necessarily beholden to the treaty position. So even where treaty structures are put in place, you should expect that there may still be some state and local tax leakage. We spent more time discussing the position of non-U.S. investors. For U.S. tax exempts, as Richard alluded to earlier, the issue is really whether or not the strategy creates unrelated business taxable income. It's a common misconception that interest from an active lending business results in unrelated business taxable income, or UBTI. In fact, that's not the case, and there's a very clear revenue ruling from the IRS on that point. What would create UBTI is debt financed income, so if a fund uses leverage to acquire loans, or if there are certain types of fee income that flows up through a fund vehicle to the tax-exempt investor. Again, a corporate blocker structure could be put in place. Blockers themselves, however, attract tax leakage. Once you've put a tax-exempt in an offshore corporate blocker, it now has the same sensitivities as a non-U.S. investor. But once again, if you can fit within the framework of the U.S. mutual fund rules that would apply to a BDC or a closed-end registered fund, you then have an elegant solution whereby you've got a U.S. entity treated as a corporation that can avoid entity-level tax and act as a blocker. So once again, another point in favor of the BDC or registered closed-end fund solution. Richard, Russell?
Great. Thank you, Adrian. Richard, did you want to touch at all on some of the underlying strategies that we're seeing in the space for these lending funds?
You know, I would say most of the strategies certainly are senior secured, right, mezzanine lending strategies, floating rate loans. Again, if it's a BDC, has to be a U.S.-focused strategy. We had one client who wanted to have more flexibility in terms of not being limited to 30% non-U.S., and as a result, they went with a closed-end fund over a BDC for that reason. They wanted the flexibility to have more than 30% of the portfolio in non-U.S. Loans and were perfectly content to live with the lower amount of leverage that a closed-end fund has. Again, I think you're right in seeing that, you know, we're looking at small to middle market companies with earnings in the $5 million, that would be certainly quite small, to $250 million range. I think that's right.
And we see in a lot of these funds, too, sponsors agreeing to certain limitations on and certain diversification requirements in terms of the investments that they're going to make. Either they're not going to make them to large companies, or that they're going to have individual loans be no more than X percent of the portfolio, et cetera. those are obviously individually negotiated, but are often an important consideration for investor appetite. We included here just a sample redacted loan portfolio from one of our clients who was willing to provide a snapshot, showing just the range that you typically see. As you see there, there's a very significant spread between the size of some of these loans and the terms of the loans, what they're negotiated, their rates and their terms, the duration, I should say. But we just want to provide a snapshot showing that there was quite a bit of variation within these individual portfolios. Valuation, this is something that we touched on earlier. Because we're talking about loans where it's not always easy to, or possible, to get any third-party insight at a public level, what often has to be done is the general partner will value it for most purposes themselves, and thus their valuation policy is something that investors will look at very carefully in order to understand how the managers are doing it. Or under certain circumstances, they'll use third-party valuation services. This especially can come into play where there's a transaction between one or more of the vehicles that the manager is running, if they have a private fund and a BDC, both in the same space, for example.
Right. I would just add, you know, I think most of our clients are using Duff & Phelps, Houlihan Lokey, a third-party valuation agent to provide that a positive assurance, right, on the valuations that they come up with for their level three assets. It's typically a range of value, right, that the Duff & Phelpses of the world are producing, and as long as the advisor's estimate of the loan is within the range, you know, we're going with the advisor's valuation. Where the advisor's valuation is outside of the range, presumably the advisor and Duff and Phelps or Houlihan are going to have a conversation about that and are going to have a back and forth in terms of perhaps some additional information that the advisor has about the borrower that maybe the valuation agent did not have that could impact, you know, some kind of resolution on where that valuation should land. But I do think using third-party valuation agents is important, and it certainly is the norm in closed-end fund and BDC land.
Given that we've used up our hour, we'll just mention briefly that we do see a variety of financing arrangements for these funds for those that do choose to use leverage. As Richard mentioned, it's a little less than half, I think, that are levered. We do see a lot of unlevered funds. A good deal of that depends on both the investor makeup and their expected returns, because some of these strategies really, in order to achieve a certain threshold, have no choice but to lever themselves up a bit. So with that, thank you very much for attending, and we look forward to seeing you next month.